be such a pleasure to have you on Perfect Strokes.
Thank you.
I was very excited about this conversation because you are that rare thing. You're a director who's working in mainstream movies, making big budget movies with massive stars, and yet underpinning them with political subtext, with very sharp messaging. How do you blend and balance all of this?
So honestly, Anupama, when I think back about it, because I often get asked this, because when I entered Bollywood, I think being apolitical was a good thing, right? People said, politics mein mat ghuso. But for me, there was no other way because it just comes naturally to me. I think as an audience also, when I used to watch films, I used to have an issue, I used to have a problem watching films where there's absolutely no social or political context and characters did not have any bearing to, you know, where they come from, what their ideology is.
And but that's a lot of movies.
So I used to, that's why I found myself gravitating towards filmmakers like Mani Ratnam.
He was the one person who always did
a larger than life mainstream film and had layers of politics running through it. And I started really loving his work and enjoying it. And then I realized why, because I'm being able to peg those characters to a context, whether it's their politics, their ideology, their social setup, where they come from, what they're thinking. And so when I started writing my own stories, that's how they came naturally to me. Kabul Express was, of course, the story of what happened with me and my friend Rajan in Afghanistan. So that was probably easier because it was, in a certain sense, autobiographical. And also, it was a much smaller budget film. It was not really what you would call a mainstream film in those days. In those days, it was called multiplex film.
Right,
except that
right.
at that time, there was only one multiplex in Bombay.
The multiplex movie, yeah. I remember that.
No song and dance,
correct.
No love story, you know, just two guys being kidnapped by a Taliban. But when it came to New York, so Adi Chopra, you know, backed this for me. And then when it came to my next film, we started discussing this film, and he said, when I told him that, you know, can we do this film against the 9/11 backdrop and illegal detentions and all, he said, sounds very political. I said, it is very political. But he said, you know what? He said, I'm apolitical. And in Kabul Express, as and when I needed to understand the politics, you allowed me to understand the politics and go along with the story. If you do that in New York, I'm game for it. And that's how we started New York, which I think is a very political film. Also,
yeah.
It's a dark film.
Yeah.
And it's politics of another country. So a lot of people were saying, like, are you sure you want to do this? But we did it, and it turned out to be quite a big commercial success. And after that, people started, you know, asking me, can we do a New York type of film? You know, I don't know what that New York type of film is. I think what they meant is that anywhere where I think the politics are in the backdrop, but they make the proceedings in the foreground larger,
right?
And allows you to probably follow the characters better because you understand them more. I think it's, see, ideology, without ideology, we are just animals. So I think if you understand the ideology of a person, it just makes you attach to that character better. And once you attach to a character, I think the audience will follow them into any world you throw them into.
But Kabir, as your scale of filmmaking has gotten bigger and bigger, has this balance become trickier?
This is the only way I can make my films. So the politics will always be in the layers beneath. I cannot write without politics. Even when I'm making 83, you'll see layers of politics running through it. And at the end of the day, politics is what? I mean, politics is not only about political parties, right? Mm. Politics is anything. The way I frame a woman is my gender politics. It's the way I look at the world. So there'll always be undercurrents of that. And I strongly feel that it always makes for an engaging viewing. Sometimes you get the balance right, and it really works. Sometimes you get the balance wrong, it doesn't work. But that's the only way that I can instinctively write. Like, you know, sometimes you get that perfect balance where at face value, you can enjoy the film without getting into the politics. But if you get into the politics, you find that film more profound, more enjoyable.
It's deeper.
I mean, Bajrangi Bhaijaan for me, for example, a very classic example of a very political film, but having a very enjoyable face value journey. The chicken song, for example, is the song that most children will say that's my favorite song from Bajrangi Bhaijaan, and they would, you know, love dancing to it. It's the most political song of the film, which is why I held it back from promotions, because actually it's a comment on the beef ban.
Right.
You know, it says Chaudhary Dhaba, aadha hai veg, aadha hai non-veg, aap spasht kijiye, aapko kya khana hai? You know, so it was basically, Chaudhary Dhaba was India. So, if we can get that balance right, then I think no amount of, you know, having a big budget or scale should deter you from saying, oh, this is a political film, will the audiences take to it? Because I think the trick is, and that's very important, if you're dealing with mainstream cinema, if you're dealing with a small, you know, 5 crore, 6 crore, 10 crore film, you can still be, use a different style. But in big budget mainstream cinema, it cannot be about the politics. The politics always has to be in the layers beneath, in the backdrop. You have to create the characters who the audiences will engage with. But then give them that ideology, give them the political backdrop.
But Kabir, now the culture has become even more polarized, even more politicized. In this environment, how does a filmmaker who wants to do this operate? Do you self-censor? Do you, when, as you write, as you create, do you think through what possible consequences can be?
Fortunately, I'm not doing that. Though, to be honest, yes, there are times when you do, when you're writing, you probably take one step back and say, what will happen? But I think that moment passes very quickly for me and I say, no, let me just...
And you commit to it.
Yeah, if I'm convinced, then my filter is only one. I'm not really looking at, when I'm writing something, I'm not going to look at, is this going to hurt the powers, whoever, you know, the ruling dispensation or people who are in power who can be hurt. My filter is very clear. Am I going to inadvertently offend somebody through this, which I don't want to do, because I think you don't have to offend people to state your politics and state them strongly. And if it passes that filter where I'm sure that, okay, I'm not going to, you know, unnecessarily for sensationalism or for whatever reason going to make a strong statement just to capture attention, and I know that it's a statement that I'm making that is very integral to the story and it's there because of a reason, then I will not stop myself. I will not censor myself.
You know, last time we talked, Kabir, you told me that I can forgive bad acting or a bad screenplay in a movie, but I can't forgive bad politics.
Yeah.
Can you speak more about that?
That is something which I feel very strongly about. And at the cost of repeating myself, yes, I can really sometimes I can deal with a bad, you know, shoddy screenplay and bad performances. But what really gets my goat is bad politics. And bad politics has sometimes even come in inadvertently. It really hurts me that why could not this filmmaker spend a little more time on figuring out what is this statement being made? And you know, to be honest, I mean, I've even been sometimes pretty shocked by well-known critics praising films that are really communal, that have terrible gender politics. And I'm saying, how could this have passed? I mean, okay, great performances, great drama, you know, well-written, tight scripts, but look at the messaging. You know, and we've seen in the recent part some huge spectacular successes where the messaging is so wrong. And I can, you know, cannot say anything to the audience because the audience maybe gets drawn in by that. At the end of the day, what is it? You know, filmmakers are basically trying to pull you into their world and make you believe whatever they want to say. And if they do it well, if they have good craft, they will make you believe that. But for people who are supposed to have a little more discerning eye, or people who are supposed to be able to read the lines, I mean the layers beneath the scenes, they should be catching it and at least calling it out, right? And yes, everything is subjective. What might be bad politics to me might be correct politics to somebody else. But I think people who think in a certain way need to call it out. We've seen it. I mean, in the case of Joker, look at the kind of polarized views that came. It was discussed. Yeah. And some people will say, no, I don't agree with that criticism. Some people will say, yes, I do agree with it. But at least it was discussed.
Yeah. Let's talk about actors. Kabir, you have worked with some of the biggest. You made 3 films with Salman. And you've been very open about how the first was difficult because you were not on the same page creatively. What is the secret to handling actors? And how do you deal with it in an ecosystem where actors have such outsized clout?
So one, I think I would not generalize actors because they're just diverse individuals. So I think a large part of a director's work is people management, which includes talent management on your set, which is your actor's management. You have to be able to read that person and see which buttons to press when and where, and how do
you... What do you mean?
So, you know, in normal life also, in your office, there are diverse individuals and you realize, okay, this one is a little extra sensitive, so I need to put this in a certain way for it to be palatable to him or her. This one is it's fine, I can say it as it is, and he or she will not take it badly, but will probably think about it in a correct perspective. Similarly, actors, you have to know, okay, if I present this in a certain way, this person will take it badly. Mm. But if I present it in a different way, he'll probably understand it better, or she will understand it better, and be able to, you know, come onto my vision easier without much of a discussion. So I think what you have to do essentially is, which I always believe in, is always draw them into a discussion. So one way I've heard some people do is just don't get into a discussion. This is a script, let's do it. I don't think that's a good way of doing it. But at some point, it'll reach a breaking point. And so that person might feel like, why am I not being, you know, consulted?
So it can't be dictatorial.
No, absolutely not. I mean, see, entire process of filmmaking, I believe, cannot be dictatorial. I truly believe that filmmaking is a hugely collaborative.
But it's your vision.
It's my vision, but part of my job as a director is to convince 150 people on the set that that vision is what they also want to invest in.
Right.
And of course, your main collaborators are your actors, right? Ultimately, they are going to be translating your vision onto screen. So I wouldn't like, okay, maybe when, you know, initially in my early part of my career, I was with bigger actors and maybe I had to tread more carefully. But even if I'm, say, become older and maybe more successful and I'm dealing with a newer actor where I can say, shut up and do
you
this.
You can bully it.
I don't think I'll do that.
Yeah.
Because I'll feel very uncomfortable. I feel uncomfortable unless I've, and it's my, if you come to my office, it's hugely democratic. Like the junior most AD will come and say something. I don't follow that hierarchical system of first AD coming in. I just love chatting with, because I think that's what makes us all relevant, right? Otherwise we lose touch with what actually is happening on the ground. So I enjoy taking feedback. Sometimes it's ridiculous and absurd and you have to tell them, shut up. But the point is, sometimes you get a perspective that had completely escaped you. And you know, even when I was working with stars like Salman, and people often say, oh, is a star interfering? I don't understand the word interfering, because the point is, if my star does not give a point of view on the scene, I'll be a little scared, because I'll feel, okay, he's just doing it, he's just sleepwalking through it and is brain dead. I would want him to give a point of view and would want to be able to counter it with my argument and take it to a point where either I convince him or he convinces me. But I don't think I ever reached a point in my films where I was ever told that do this or
it's my way or the highway.
Not, never, never. And for that, I really respect. See, Ek Tha Tiger was my third film. In the world of mainstream cinema, I just had a small hit like New York behind me. He had done God knows how many films. He could have easily said, you know, it's my way or the highway. He never said that. He sulked, he argued, he everything, but never said.
What do you do when Salman Khan sulks?
Yeah, you still have to say, okay, so ye kar lete hain, aise kar lete hain, but he still. So he, I think, and that is, I often say that. I think maybe that's because of the way Salim Saab has always conducted himself. There is something that is in the value system of Salman which never allowed him to disrespect the director. And he always did go with your vision, sometimes reluctantly, sometimes he would convince you or make you feel, okay, let's do a, you know, that's why I say the first film was a little difficult, because sometimes you say, okay, let's do middle ground and take it forward. But having said that, I definitely always like to engage with my actors and take their point of view, because you never know, out of those 10 points that they come up, you might not agree with 9, but there'll be one gem that you should not lose. And come
that'll
on,
add value.
If you know, Salman is a superstar for a reason, right? And there will always be that one thing that he will know, which I will not know. So I never will try and block the inputs coming in.
Yeah. You know, but with big stars also comes the whole box office pressure. And I remember another conversation we had had once, I think it was around Ek Tha Tiger, where you said to me that the box office is now a spectator sport. Yeah. You said on that first day, people are not talking about achhi film hai, buri film hai. They're just saying opening kya thi. You know, as a storyteller, Kabir, how do you make peace with that?
I'm still uncomfortable with it, but I have to live with it. But I've, the only thing I can do for myself is don't let myself get too either bogged down by it or start actually believing in that. I think numbers are just numbers. And they are things that strangely, I guess because of internet and stuff, audiences have started discussing and loving it. I don't think in the 70s, 80s, anybody knew. I think
not
nobody
at all.
Knows
till the
how
90s,
much
nobody
made,
knew. Yeah, you know, Nas building mein talk, there
exactly.
was talk about
so
it, but otherwise
you,
nobody
you
knew.
You didn't know what,
yeah.
what numbers were. So I don't let them affect me too much. Neither when the numbers are very good, and neither when the numbers are bad. Because I think that's very important for a filmmaker. In mainstream cinema, you want to last long. If you take your success too seriously, you'll get destroyed by your failures. I think just remain even keel. And that is something I again must mention that I learned from my formative years in Yash Raj. You know, I realized in Yash Raj, this is a cocoon. You know, your film is a blockbuster, you're still the same. Your film is a disaster, you're still the same. We're still going to be eating lunch at the same table, chatting the same way with Adi
kuch,
and Yash.
Kuch nahi
badal raha. Yash Chopra is not going to change his behavior if your film is a flop or a success. He's still going to be the ever indulgent father figure of Yash Raj, irrespective of what your commercial success or failure is. And I think those 6 years really helped me, come to terms with. So, I mean, fortunately, all my films in Yash Raj were a success. But I could see from all the other fellow co-directors that numbers should not be taken too seriously.
But what do you do on that Friday when your film is releasing? Are you plugged in or
no.
do you plug out?
No, I plug out.
Completely?
Not completely, but I don't dive in deep.
Tell me, Kabir, what's the most practical advice that you've ever got about being a director, which you use in life?
I think, I don't know whether it's advice that was actually articulated, but I think it's a repeat of what I said earlier, which came from the ethos of Yash Raj and from people like Adi, is don't take your success too seriously. I think that for filmmakers in this industry, especially mainstream cinema, is a very, very important.
But how do you do that? Practically, how do you do it?
I guess it's also a personality type, but you have to be even-headed about it. Because as they say, it's a cliche, but they often say that success has destroyed more people in this industry than failures have.
Absolutely.
And I've seen that. You know, it's now been more than a decade that I've been here in this industry. A lot of friends who are my fellow filmmakers who came with me from Delhi or people I've met over here. And I've seen that. Sometimes one big film, like, you know, that one blockbuster film, I've seen their careers being destroyed.
Yeah.
Because they're suddenly gone off balance in their expectations, in the amount of the sense of entitlement that suddenly comes, and therefore then that translates to the way you're dealing with people. I think if that happens, then it's the game is over. So I think that is for filmmakers who are dabbling in mainstream cinema, that's the most important thing to say. And for first-time filmmakers, which I often say because I'm from a film school, I'm from Jamia, the infamous Jamia now. And a lot of kids who have just come out of Jamia come to me to have a chat. I always say in your first film or your first two films, make sure you are reflected in it. Because that's the only thing that will cut through the clutter. Don't try and make a film that you feel is, perfect in terms of the way you're shooting it and acting. I said, unless your personality comes, if I know you, I should be able to see this film and say, that's Anupama's film.
Correct.
If it's going to be just a clone of what you feel are successful films, you won't go the distance. And I think that's very, very important.
Yeah. Some personal stamp.
Some personal. It has to be in the way you're making it, in what you're saying in the film. Be crystal clear about what you want.
What
your vision is.
Yeah.
But always be open to that one perspective that will make your vision better.
Right.
Don't block yourself from everything.
Right.
Bas ye banana hai aur aisi banana hai aur sab kuch bakwas hai. Nahi hai. Because a film, as it's being, it's a very dynamic
It's a living
process,
thing.
Right? It's a living thing.
Yeah.
As it's being made, it's going somewhere.
Yeah.
Right? And every day you're getting inputs. It's from the light, it's from the location, it's from your ADs, it's some response from your actor, or it's the way an actor's read a line. Sometimes it happens, some actors there and say, read, and he or she reads it in a certain way. I'm saying, wait a minute, this sounds good.
Yeah.
I didn't think of it this way. I said, just continue with this. That's why in my first take, I try and hide from the actors.
What do you mean?
And this is happening more as I'm getting more films under my belt. So what happens is that I realize that if I say something, an actor will say, oh, Kabir sir has said this, so I have to do this. So what I do is I try and hide in sense. I don't want to tell them what I'm wanting them. I have said, I've discussed the whole script with you. I've given you the context. I've given you the background. I've told you where this character is coming. I want to see how you've understood that character. Please do what you think of the character.
So the first take is the actor's take.
Actor's take. And because I don't want to stop any of his or her thinking process. Because if I stop that, I'll never know what he was thinking. There have been so many times when an actor has done something in an audition where I've changed the script.
Really?
So many times. I've seen auditions of a character and that because at that time they're not interacting with me, they're interacting with my casting director. And they've done an audition and I said, oh my God, this sounds so much better than what I was thinking. And I've rewritten that. In every film, I'll say that.
Yeah, I always
see all auditions. I never let my assistants, shortlist two of the best and give it to me.
Really?
Because two of their best might not be two of my best. You know, there are times in auditions you can make out, okay, this guy's not doing a good job of the scene, but he has the material to work with. Mm. I have to step in as a director and make him or her perform. It's like Munni, right? When Munni comes, 6-year-old girl, I'm not going to judge her for acting.
Correct.
I just want to see the raw material there.
Yeah.
Is she open to being, is she directable?
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Well, so, she was a masterstroke.
Yeah, she was lovely.
You had me as soon as she was in the frame. But this has been so lovely, Kabir. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Always a pleasure.